happens in the current context in our country, where we have to do some focus work. So when we are going to address childhood headache, the importance is not only from a health perspective. The headache, I will enlighten you in the lecture, has its own importance from the economic point of view. Certain countries, the economic department, they calculate the production loss because of headache, and they try to invest money on eliminating headache in order to ensure their productivity and the development of a country. Especially countries like Australia, they calculate in rupees and pence or India dollars to see what impact not on inside the adult as well. And so the objectives of the lecture is that, like this, first two, to talk about what the headache is. People even for toothache, they might have as headache. So we have defined what headache is. Then the relevance in the global context and the local context. That's why I said when you are going to address our health system and its contribution to the country from all angles, not only for the sustainable development. But relevance of discussing and capacity building in this knowledge and the skills to our medical community, but impact will have at the end positive impact. Then the evolution of the headache, most importantly from a medical community, how are you going to approach headache, childhood headache? Then two of my registrars are going to touch the migraine, tension type headaches, and finally I will touch the intervention I have is not rather than the treatment, the interventions that we can adapt in order to overcome the childhood headache problems. So first of all, we'll see the definition. Now, according to the International Headache Society, their own publication line, they have defined what the head is. So it starts from here down to that place. So whatever you have, the sinus headache on the maxillary sinus, not coming in the facial thing, not coming under the territory of headaches. So international classification of headache disorders, that's the third edition which is available at the moment, the quality version, the second version, which was published in the latest way back in 2013, 7 years old, but that is what is relevant at the moment. So, the next point what I want to highlight is the impact. Though I am going to touch the childhood headache, the impact is not only on the child. That is very crucial. So, the first of all, the child impact, according to the published material, obviously his health will get affected. And the headache is there. More than that, his education will get affected. Not only the education, but even the extracurricular activities. Simply, his quality of life will get deranged when you have headache in place. Then, they will not confine the matter to themselves. That parents will really get agitated in the headache. And then, that will have an impact on public or published materials, on the economy or the productivity, and there will be some turbulence in the family, which is not normal, which will have impact. So therefore, childhood headache will not get only confined to the child. The other siblings will, there is published material says there are a certain amount of neglect will come into practice, there are certain other activities also, so therefore, in certain countries, how the siblings should behave when there is a headache in their family, trained and in touch in their counseling processes and other activities. That is why we started the headache clinic at Lady Ridge Hospital, but we haven't come to that level to counsel the siblings because of the numbers we handle per day. Then the society, this is what the governments use to calculate, not only the childhood headache, the financial burden they calculate. And I remember in 2013 it was calculated for 50 billion in Australia dollars. Australian dollars in their country, and they tried to remove some money out of it in order to reduce the impact. And that is the very reason there is International Headache Directorate in the WHO. And Professor Timothy Steen is heading that unit, and he visited me 4 times during the last 7 years. He's heading the head of Sri Lankan cardiac work, taking place in the hospital. And actually, we manage pediatric headache by extrapolating from the adult headache algorithm. So we were working hard to develop a pediatric algorithm in Sri Lanka, which is yet to happen. Unfortunately, the study we collected about materials from 500 children, which we lost actually, unfortunately, because we gave it to somebody to analyze. He had migrated out of the country and the material is missing. We have to leave the thing. Anyway, so this childhood headache has impact up to the, so that is why I said when you are focusing our health topics, this taking place as the first topic, not because of me doing that there is a relevance. And importantly, when it comes to the specifically to the childhood headache, there are a lot of challenges that we go through. The first, of course, is there are guidelines and the diagnostic criteria to be fulfilled with regard to this. But unfortunately, at the presentation, obviously, you know, they are not very sound enough to give clear evidence as well. Even if you ask them to pinpoint which place is paining, when you ask for the second time, they show up another place. So because of the age range and their inadequacies, we struggle, and so we call it a vague kind of presentation. And secondly, this is unique to pediatrics, that is, we get the information by proxy, because the third party is giving information. So we don't have the privilege, like adult practice, to understand, or from the straight away to get the first-hand information, we get second-hand information, or sometimes third-hand information. Then, as I told you, now this new entity is what we were trying to kind of conceptualize and present to the world at the headache trade, which we failed because of this loss of material. That is this, we have the diagnostic criteria for migraine, tension type headache, so on and so forth, but there may be the process of evolving into one of these criteria. So they are not fulfilled the criteria as it does by the adult population. So therefore we try to introduce a new terminology called the so-called immature headache yet to happen because of the evolving process. It is just until you match the criteria as adults. So therefore we are again underprivileged that we don't have the ability to use the criteria plus to utilize that criteria for pediatric practice. Then the etiology, it varies because they are in the growing age. You obviously know when their hormones are changing time to time. So based on that, their vascular and the neurochemicals activities will vary. So sometimes we have to understand their basic principles of their physiology. Plus, we added with physiology because nowadays, especially with regard to Sri Lanka, some kids, they get up around 4 o'clock to go to school. They may be in the van. They may be in the van for about 4 hours, 5 hours per daylight. The school hour is only 7 hours. They may be in the van for about 5 hours sometimes, up and down. So because of that, this dynamicity, then the parental expectations, the peer expectations, the teacher's expectations, and all have to be matched. So therefore, it's a bit of a complex situation. We have to manage. We can't really apply the international criteria as it is into our headache management. Then, management, of course, it is always how the parents are going to prioritize their headache, child headache. Sometimes they over-prioritize, and sometimes they are over-anxious, and sometimes they don't care at all. So, based on that, we have to manage this child headache. And some headaches are common in adults and some headaches are not seen in children. But when they are in the adolescent age, because now the LRH used to accommodate up to 14 years, may go up to 16 years, sometimes our neurology subspecialized clinics go up to 18 years, 20 years, we may be handling sometimes the adult range as well to some extent. Then the causes of headache may vary from adults, and one of the important things is headache presented before 5 years are mostly secondary headaches. That is, so therefore, if a child, before going to school, if they complain of a headache, it is better you take it very seriously. And I am not asking you to go and do an MRI or CT scan on all these patients, but it is better you encourage them to understand and evaluate them in the full context, because mostly it can be secondary headaches, so it can be attended than the, more than, better than the primary headaches. Then the school absences. Now this is a very important thing. The impact or the productivity of a school-going child is to go to school and to do better at school, the education, and the extracurricular activities. Now, because of the headache, when these things get affected, that itself might secondary cause sometimes headaches, especially when they not go for school for about 1 month, 2 months, then that itself might precipitate them to have a headache on its own. So therefore, the aggressive ways of managing patients to entertain their concern and the complaints is really cost effective in this game. That is why we dedicated a separate clinic for headache at LRH, and it is well attended, and success stories, I will talk at the discussion session, is really rewarding. And since we were trained by Dr. B.J. Sipper and them, we have the habit of starting the clinic at early morning around 7 o'clock, so the some school children around the, in and around LRH, they come to the clinic, and by 8 o'clock they are back to school. So, those are learned principles from our predecessor school principal. And another point, as I told you, I calculated from economic point of view, this headache. At the same time, Dr. Teresa Vance, they say that most parents who seek help for their child with headache are looking only for proper reassurance. Proper, I put that word, proper reassurance. Because if you do halfway through, they will go for doctor shopping. So this is very cost effective. We do have to say that there is nothing wrong. When you say with confidence, after proper examination and so on and so forth. But then when you ask them to come back in, say, 2 months or 3 months, when they are really well with whatever we have said, that itself will make them better. And that will not only to the child, as I told you, to the parents, siblings, and to the society, all will be looked after. So headache is a bit of a going out of medicine life of a topic. Then we will come to the why this headache is that important. That is another point is because of this British publication, that is a kind of landmark publication way back in 1950s, ultimately later published in 1962, by using 6,000 children, he concluded, and it is, that is what is accepted even in American literature, is to say that the number of headache complaints is around 40% at when they are in grade 2. By the time they are adolescent, it goes up to about 70-80%. So this is the kind of world accepted kind of epidemiology with regard to headache. This is possibly the once complaint. But if you see the real prevalence of headache at this stage is about 2.5%, and this age around 15%. Is the rough prevalence. This is, I would say, those are the serious headaches, because it's difficult to say the seriousness and all these things that might vary. So, according to the American publications, they say that by 7 years, about 2.5% of children have so-called serious headaches, and these 15 years, we have 15% of so-called serious headaches. And so the prevalence is around that range. Now let's understand the pathophysiology. This is very important. We see some, whenever the headache child approaches a doctor, we have seen the prescriptions giving 3 or 4 drugs with a vitamin and asking them to come into the clinic every month. So they don't know what has happened. They don't know how they should cope up with the headache. Nothing is being trained at very 5 minutes, 3 minutes channel session. You give a couple of drugs, sometimes 4 drugs, for them to have this, probably I would call it a cocktail. I would say that is very bad, because in our experience for last 10 years running a headache clinic at Lady Ripley Hospital, I'm not talking about the adult headache, I'm talking about the pediatric headache, 85% I don't give any medicine. So sometimes it is, my clinic is called the water clinic, because I ask them to drink water, and that itself will settle their problems. Because if you see the UNICEF studies which were published, there is a water unit in UNICEF encouraging and promoting children to drink water. That has a, that there are certain strategies and activities going on by the UNICEF by funding them in order to promoting children to drink water. So how we are going to analyze this brain pathophysiology? First of all, you have to understand this brain is not sensitive organ. I am talking about the brain proper. It's not sensitive. So because even but then who are generating this pain will have to be. So arteries, veins, when there is vasodilation, there can be pain sensitization causing headache. Not the brain proper is, no, even if there is a tumor, I will come to that. Then the periosteal, there you have neurons or nerve endings where you will pick pain. And then you have scalp, that is, you know, there are 5 layers on top. They have pain sensation, so that will cause. And then the sinus mucosa has pain sensation. So if the sensation is on this frontal sinus, then of course it is coming into the defined territory of head, and that they will complain it has headache. So we have to verify whether it is coming from the inside of the head or from the sinuses. Then you know there is a temporomandibular joint here, people will, and that it just connects to the line of definition of headache, and so that also may sometimes give. And the teeth and gingival pains, you know, there is this trigeminal supply, and so the same innovations might give wrong impression that you are having headache when you have pains on these areas. So therefore, when the headache, when the child comes with headache, it is our duty to go into, rather than just to highlight what is there, just not to say just a migraine patient, we have to see what actually, as Professor Cherity has taught us, to go into the pathophysiology and see what exactly is giving this pain. That is very important. What part of the, because the pain can be generated not by the brain but the rest of the other supportive tissues around. So therefore, what part is actually causing pain will have to be visited, rather than going through either tension type headache criteria or migraine criteria. It is very bad. We have to see what how this pain is being generated in the head. And that is why even in American literature, they say, sometimes they don't say headache, they say head pain. Because it is not really headache which might get presented as headache. So before you go into the pathophysiology, first of all, how the pathophysiology will be generated will have to be taught. And then when you come to the how the mechanism of it, so the pain, regardless of this etiology, they will come and complain as headache, especially if it is worse in the pediatric age range, because they don't know where it is coming, and they will come and say, they will show the head. And the head and neck pain, you know, the supply is from the trigeminal nerve, so therefore the vasculature, trigeminal, so we have to see what is the etiology, whether it is the neurons or is it the vascular component, or it can be the rest of the other organs I listed are causing. Then the pain generation is simply because of the recognized chemicals are the serotonin and this 5-HT receptors. So these are, I will go into the other chemicals also as well. So what chemicals are causing this? Because the management of this, the pharmacological management is basically aiming at these chemicals. But if you really touch the anatomy of it, how this pain is being generated in the head, then sometimes we will be able to handle that situation without going into the pharma treatment. What they say is, as usual in our Western medicine, for anything we call it multifactorial. I mean, because I have attended enough seminars at other alternative medicines, and they always ask, because for diabetes we say multifactorial, hypertension we say multifactorial, epilepsy we say multifactorial, headache we say multifactorial, so yeah, it's a fact. So we have a very good excuse to say, when we don't know the etiology, what actually, we don't have the privilege of managing these patients with etiology base. We manage as evidence-based means you go collect the evidence and then treat. So therefore the etiology might vary. So therefore this is not only for the headache. If we call it very complex and multifactorial, to be safe in our pathophysiology explanation, not to say that we don't know, that initial thinking of this tension type headache was for a very simple way. They said, now the tension headache people are like this all the time, so therefore this temporalis muscle may be pulling it out. So because of that, this area comes with pain in time when they are like this, whether they are watching the television or whether they are reading a book or even otherwise, they are like this. So then we will have the temporal muscle, all this pulled up like holding something on your hand and then you have a pain on your hand, this muscle will be really tense and there will be tenderness around that. So there you are very comfortably we have said that there is a kind of a band-like tension headache. This theory has been basically defeated now, and what they say is no, it is not the reason, and they say it is again coming from inside and the neurochemicals and other things are playing a role. So therefore, when we are going to explain the tension headache, it's a contribution of the central and peripheral factor, and it is from the neural sensitivity pattern changing by the pain sensitization mechanism is being taken place by neurochemicals or the pain receptors and the rest, rather than talking in favor of contraction of the muscle. But maybe both may be participating because there are certain personalities always they are worrying. So therefore, whether that group is coming. So this is how, because that previous theory has been defeated to some extent. I am quoting from the Headache Classification Committee in 2013, it might vary in time. And migraine, of course, the explanation starts from the brain stem, actually, that region they start. And what happens is the mechanism is a bit of a, I don't think it's complicated. There is two theories they explain in the American literature. They say the vascular theory is one, and then the neurovascular theory or the neurogenic theory is another one. What they say is the neurogenic theory has been much more accepted than the vascular theory at the moment. What they say is there is a phase that the neurons will get, I will go into the phases of migraine in time, just for blanket explanation, to say there will be a phase of neural suppression in the brain. So when there is a suppression, the blood vessels will get agitated, then there will be vasodilation, and then there will be pain generated through that mechanism. That is how it is been explained. This is not that fully understood. But so that start, that is why this vomiting and other activities are taking place in this territory, and because of this brain stem region, you know, the occipital lobe is very close by. So therefore, in the migraine, you have, you see various colors, chromas, all these things, vascular kind of, not vascular, the visual kind of signs and symptoms coupled up with this migraine is because of that, because of the territorial. But the pain to generate and to receive pain, it has to travel to the thalamus and then to the cortex, and it will be received as a pain sensation. Ultimately, they will complain. So the chemicals involved, as I told you, the previous chemicals, the 5-HT and this vasodilator and all these substance P and all these neurochemicals will give rise to that kind of a pain. So I am explaining the anatomy and the available physiology. So the two theories as I listed, the vascular hypothesis, they say the vascular constriction and then there will be a vascular dilatation. This is the phase where the pain will come and then there will be hanging over pain for some time. The neurogenic theory is what is I explained just a moment ago. So that is to have a deeper depression of the neurons to some time and then that will reflex like generate the activities and then so we will clinically how these concepts are going to touch, we will see. So this is another kind of same thing to be explained in a different mode. Right, then the secondary headaches, of course, it's a simple theory, anybody will understand. When there is, this is a closed environment, we have a skull bone, it is hard. So therefore, if there is any correction here, what will happen is there will be high outgoing intracranial pressure and that will create pain and sometimes vomiting and so on and so forth. So secondary headaches, of course, can be easily explained, but I just explained the tension headache and the migraine headache through the available explanation. Then if there is inflammation of the brain and meninges, again that might add up to the stimulation of the nerve receptors further. So therefore, the comfortable ways of handling headache is by classifying it into two categories. That is, the secondary headache is headache due to some other reason, but when you can't find the headache, it's a headache society, they are coming under the primary headache. From a pediatric point of view, if you can understand the basic principle of migraine and tension headaches is more than enough, because other headaches are almost, I only see also only one cluster headache patient in pediatric practice, so then all neurologists can get together and practice, so we can get a collaboration to manage that child. So these are the two things which are common. So when you take the migraine is the most studied version of headache, and tension headache is the most common version of headache. This is the most studied version. This is a beautiful thing because of the most studied, it is the commonest. No, the commonest it is, but this is, it is like that generalized epilepsy and focal epilepsy. People think that generalized epilepsy is common and not the other way. So similarly here. And secondary headache, just for the completeness, I'm not going to touch that. Again, is that you can have sinus headaches. When you have the sinus inflammation, basically ENT surgeons will help us to manage. Then the head trauma, the post-trauma headache, post-traumatic headache. Then the SOLs can give rise to headache. Then benign intracranial hypertension, when you can't find the SOL but still the pressure is high, then you call it the benign intracranial hypertension. It's no matter to call it benign. And then meningeal irritations due to inflammation and infections, then the medication overuse headache. I would like to touch this here because people think by giving paracetamol or other medications kept on giving for a long time, it is that itself is causing the so-called medication overuse headache. Of course, rather than just listing the migraine and the tension type headache, I have listed as the third, that the medication overuse headache, but it is coming under the secondary headache, so that is why it is listed there. It's not a primary headache, but medication overuse headache, is there is classifications in the literature. I am just touching that. They say if you use paracetamol every day or every other day or once a week or 1 week per month, so based on that there are kind of diagnostic criteria on this medication overuse headache, but the fact remains here, these medications itself will generate headache in your head, and the management, and the interesting thing is the management sometimes goes up to giving steroids sometimes, we can't, so you are on either path. So coming down to the primary headaches, is migraine is the topic, and so I have drawn this thing, but that is again maybe misleading to you. In the pediatric practice, sometimes this picture, whether this adult kind of pattern, you have the unilateral headache, but that is not unique in the pediatric practice, it varies. They might say other side, or you might say somewhere here. So, and the pictorial presentation of the headache, if you see our clinic book, there we have added some material. Unfortunately, I can bring a book, our clinic book. There is that publication from the ARAD. To say that when a child is given a half sheet to draw where it's pain, there is a 40% sensitivity to the diagnosis of what they draw, to see whether it is a tension headache or migraine or what, because of to get the exact size and how that is paining. So therefore that is another tool the pediatrician can use when I'm going to manage. But this is in adult headache, it's usually considered one-sided. So as I told you, the hypothesis is I have already explained the hypothesis vascular neurogenic. And classification of migraines. So people talk migraine with or eye is not the commonest. Without or eye is what is common. Then there are other complicated migraines. So to list them, say I will be hemiplegic migraine, patellar migraines, acute convulsional state, and so on and so forth. So the hemiplegic migraine, of course, they might get end up in a stroke unit sometimes, not knowing that it is migraine. In the patellar migraine, sometimes they end up in SO, investigating into SOS and all these things in the posterior fossa, because they exactly they don't know. Then the conclusion stage, they might end up in kind of acute encephalopathies and so on and so forth. But and obviously the pathophysiology may be the same, because in the encephalopathy, the brain neurons are not in full efficient or optimum functioning. So therefore, in the vascular process or the neurogenic process is not facilitated, neurochemicals or vascular process is not optimizing the their function, definitely there will be issues similar to strokes or vascular area malfunctions. Migraine with aura is what it is better to learn, because then only we will be able, then we can drop the aura and think about without aura. So therefore, with aura is, as I told you, the brainstem and the regional cortex, that is the occipital cortex is what is getting affected. So you have the vomiting and then the visual symptoms, the sensory symptoms, motor, and might spread up to the speech and language issues also to some extent, and sometimes there will be cognitive issues as well. But basically what we are touching is visual symptoms are the common things. And the complicated migraine, of course, has to be touched on the neurology examination and so on and so forth. Hemiplegic migraine, it can be a weakness or paresis, or it can be sensory disturbance for some time. Then the bacillary migraine, of course, they will have their visual issues, and then the seventh nerve can get, eighth nerve and seventh nerve can get affected. Then they will have all these sixth, seventh, eighth nerve can get affected because they are on the, well, they are related to posterior. Then if there is cerebral extension, you might get even ataxia, and then you call it a bacillary migraine. This is unusual. Right, this is a very important from this register point of view, and if you can, this will really explain the clinical scenario. I have explained the pathophysiology, now we are coming to the clinical scenario. So there are four stages. The first stage is the prodrome period, and then you have the last stage is the postdrome period. So pro and postdrome periods. Okay. Then coming to the proper, you have two components, the aura and the headache phase. So altogether there are four phases. That is the prodromal phase, then you come to the aura, then you go into the headache proper, then you might have a hang-on, migraine hangover, that is postdrome period. So these are the four phases, and we'll see what happens very clearly. This is, I think, the most vital side in this entire presentation to understand. So what will happen in the stage one, prodrome? How many days it can proceed before the headache real phase? Is the headache phase, is the aura, and we only know the aura and the headache. These two components are being missed most of us. So that is why I highlighted that. The prodrome phase is, it can be coming several days before. That is important. So he may be upset for a couple of days, and then they will get. So if the parents can pick that situation, they will be able to give their management, so may be able to abort upcoming headache phase when the child is abnormal. But then, so then the second phase is aura phase. So aura phase is, you can see roughly now, sorry. Here, of course, the rough percentage is about, they say roughly about half of all migraines will get this prodrome phase. I don't know whether that information is correct. Practical experience, but this is what is published. And so roughly half of them will get suffer at this stage. Then, but the aura will continue for about 20% of the patient. That's why I told migraine with aura is not the commonest. Without aura is what is common. And then the third phase. Now the third phase is where you get the headache, and it can be moderate to severe, and it might last for up to 72 hours. That is another point what we have to highlight. So then there will be mismatch in your phases. That is why I told it can go up to that level. And then during that phase, they will avoid light, they will avoid noises, and they will like to be on calm and quiet place somewhere, possibly some darkness. They will not like to go out and see, so they will not like to play with the rest, and they will be like tired looking, and they will try to avoid all these trigger items like noises, and they will have nausea on top of it. Then the postdrome period, they will hang on, that will last for about several days sometimes. So these are the four phases from a clinical point of view. Am I clear? Yeah. So now I explained the pathophysiology, now I wrote it down to the clinical scenarios of this migraine. Now, this is, we are in the phase of migraine, the more studied version of the primary headache. And diagnosis of migraine, we are not privileged enough to manage it from a criteria point of view. To that extent, I told you the mental headaches, and we will struggle to put them under criteria, but for your completeness sake, the International Headache Society in the 2013 criteria are as follows, and it had to last for about 2 days, And these are the features, at least two features, like the unilateral or bilateral, then pulsating, the child will struggle to say what is this pulsating all about. And then moderate the severe intensity and then aggravated by those triggers. Then during the phase of, at least there should be either nausea or photophobia or phonophobia. So these are the diagnostic criteria for to say that it is, we have diagnostic criteria, fulfilled migraine will be set like that. In addition, right, then coming down to the tension headache, this is a picture which will, for your, okay, will be able to keep in your mind that this is how they complain, and but it goes up to this area. And interestingly, nowadays these children have a lot of pain here, and that will have big impact on their quality of life. Unlike, because they are not climbing trees, they don't play much. Because of that, like elderly crowd, they have the pain here, and that will bring down their quality of life heavily. So therefore, it's very important that we add on to their tension headache. So relaxing this by doing a couple of relaxing exercises and asking them to do a couple of neck exercises is crucial in management. Those are the techniques we use in our headache clinic rather than the pharma in order to come out from headache. So the tension headache, people claim that it is obviously because of stress. So how the stress is going to be get concentrated in this area is what you have to understand. That is a point which you can kind of dig into. And it is usually the neck and occipital is there, and then there is a continuous pain. So children who are carrying this big bag also will come and complain neck pain. Then people, children who are using these melodicas and all these things, their parade bands and all these parades, then they keep these gadgets for about 2-3 hours, then again they will have pain here. So how are you going to differentiate that? So therefore you have to go into a careful history and what they really do. And usually they don't have nausea and these abdominal pains, which are basically directing us towards the migraine, and the family history is another thing, is less likely. So this is how we try to come down to the tension headache territory. But it's a struggle with this big bag and with 13 subjects in schools, so 14 subjects sometimes. They're supposed to carry all these bags and then they are not thin. And nowadays, kids are not keeping their shoulders like this. The shoulders are mostly like this, so that again, will generate a lot of positional pain on this backside and the back of the chest. The IHS diagnostic criteria, they say it has to be pressing and tightening, not pulsatile. So pulsatile is reserved for the migraine, but it's difficult to differentiate sometimes. And the frontal and occipital, I told you, is band-like. Then it is moderate intensity and not aggravated. So that is how they come to develop the diagnostic criteria for tension headache. So other types of headaches is so-called cluster headache, sinus headache, head trauma, and vena intercalary. I am not going to discuss because then I will not be able to finish. So then the migraine case three to adapting to your protocol, which my two registrars will present the case study.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking about a patient who is followed up in our clinic for migraine. It's a 12-year-old child who was previously migraine. She presented to our clinic 4 months back. So the initial complaint was a headache for 4 months. There is a voice clip of her.
Thank you.
involved with. The child talks about her complaints, actually. Unfortunately, we are unable to hear her voice there. She talks about her headache and she says that how it has affected her studies. And she was in the first and second term test, she was first. She had the first rank and with this nickname, her marks has come down and also she has her rank of the rank in the class also gone down to the fourth place. She complained the headache was in the temporal region because bilateral in distribution and there was no radiation of the headache. In IHS guidelines, usually the headache, midday headaches are usually bilateral, but when it comes to the childhood midway, the childhood midways are most of the time bilateral. The child complained that she had a severe pain and almost daily, the headache was almost daily on weekdays and during the weekends. And the duration was the headache lasted for 6 hours. And she complained that she had photophobia and colophobia. And the headache was also associated with vomiting and nausea. And she complained that she had an aura which started like 2 hours before the headache. Like she said that she could see some moving insects in front of her eyes and some flashing lights. And the child was unable to eat during the headache and she often skips her meals. She had to sleep for 6 hours daily because of this headache until it settles. And she has not identified any aggravating factors yet. And according to the child, the headache has not responded to paracetamol. Not significant. She didn't have any headache prior to this, and there was no history of head injury, seizures before. She is an outstanding student in her class, but as I told you before, her rank has come down from first to fourth, and also her marks also has come down. And she has a family history of headache. Her paternal uncle had suffered from migraine during his childhood. There is no family history of seizure or brain tumor or stroke. On examination, her vitals were normal, though she was 52 centimeters. Both parameters were within normal limits and she was oriented and alert. She didn't have any neurocutaneous stigmata. The pupils were reacting to light bilaterally and there was no facial asymmetry. The neck, she didn't have any restriction of movements of the neck. Cardiovascular system was normal and the blood pressure was normal. Abdominal and respiratory examination was unremarkable. in the neurologic evaluation, her cranial nerves examination was normal, fundoscopy was normal, there was no papillary edema, no cerebellar sign, and her power tone reflexes were normal in all four limbs. This is the photograph of the clinic book. So it, this is the first page of the first clinic visit. This page contains all the information about the child. This is a 12-year-old child, all the family history, her development history, everything is contained in this page. So we usually give a impression on the first visit. We usually don't jump to a diagnosis. We after following up for like several months and analyzing her symptoms, then only we usually go to a diagnosis. So on the first visit, according to her history and findings, we have come to an impression of migraine. So you can see in this box, it's an impression we have given, not a diagnosis. About the treatment and management approach, my consultant will talk to you, and the next case will be taken by Dr. A.R. Lianagi. Thank you, Dr. Sharma. I will be discussing about a case history of a child who presented with a headache and came to a conclusion of a tension type headache. So, our patient was a 12-year-old, previously healthy boy who came to our, who was referred to our pediatric neurology clinic from the OPD of the Lake Ridgeview Hospital. And he complained of severe headache, which has been there for the past 3 years duration. And in this case, when we talk about the duration of the headache and the onset, the International Headache Society describes tension type headache as a having a usually more gradual onset than when compared with migraine. So in our case history, that tallies with the description given by the International Headache Society. Since it was a child, they can't describe exactly the type of the quality of the headache. So he was not able to describe it as a throbbing type of headache, but he just explained that the headache was involving the entire head. So he was unable to describe the type and describe the pain as a severe, unbearable pain involving the entire head. But according to the International Headache Society criteria, the tension type headache is described as a fullness or tightening band-like sensation involving the frontotemporal region. But when we manage headache in pediatric population, they're not actually able to describe the headache like this. So that is one of the problems that we come we have to face when we are managing pediatric patients. And also the pain is a continuous type of a headache. And there were no other features associated with the headache, such as vomiting, nausea, or abdominal pain. And in our case history also, this our patient did not have any other clinical features, such as vomiting or abdominal pain. That is consistent with the International Headache Society criteria for the diagnosis of tension headache. And I have a short video clip, I don't think we are playing here. So I'll describe the history given by the mother. And the mother mother explained to us that the child, since now he's 12 years of age, the headache started when he was preparing for his grade 5 scholarship examination. So he has been attending about 4 fusion classes for the grade 5 scholarship examination, so waking up very early in the morning and coming home late at night. So the headache had started during that time, and also she explained that the headache, when he gets the headache, it lasts for a couple of hours, and there was some response to analgesics, and also it is relieved with sleep and rest. So that is consistent with a tension type headache, and there were no features to there were no photophobia or phonophobia, and his school attendance or his other activities were not affected by the headache. So that is also tallied with the diagnosis of a tension type headache, because unlike in migraine, tension type headache will not affect your day-to-day you will not miss out on school because of the headache, unlike in migraine. So it's not actually aggravated by physical activities. So that is the IHS criteria for the diagnosis of tension type headache. This is the video. You can apply it here. And the rest of the, and also another thing that was important in the history was that the mother said that after the scholarship exam was over, the child had a symptom-free period for about 1.5 years, and then again, when he went to a new class in grade 7 and 8, the pain started because the competition had been too much, and because of that, and they were the parents were also both academics, and they wanted to push the child to perform better in school. So at that time, the headache also reappeared, and the rest of the history did not reveal any significant findings, and there was no past history of head trauma, and there was no family history of migraine, seizures, brain tumors, or strokes. Moving on to the physical examination, his vitals were normal, and the OFC was 51 centimeters, which was within normal range, and the growth parameters were also normal, and he was well and alert. And in the general examination, there were no significant findings, and there was no facial asymmetry, any neurocutaneous stigmata, and he had full range of neck movements, and the fundoscopy examination was unremarkable with no evidence of papillary edema. The cardiovascular system examination was normal with normal blood pressure, and the respiratory system examination and abdominal examination were all unremarkable. Neurologic evaluation, the cranial nerve examination was again normal, and the upper limb and lower limb motor system examination was also normal. And he did not have any cellular signs. So this is the clinic book, and Dr. Sharma explained, so on the first visit, we don't write the diagnosis as such. So considering the history given by the patient and the clinical examination findings, we come to an impression. We get the impression of a tension type headache. So this is the impression given by the history and the examination was a tension type headache. The management aspects of headache will be discussed by the subject.
This is actually my handwriting on the first page of the clinic book, and the patient, obviously, they have at home, mother, father, and they have pregnancy, all this we have been covered. Then coming down to the criteria, so we touch all the criteria, but still we keep on here. Impression of the management, and so this is the first page. I have kept it blank for the rest of my multiple in detail. So this is very important. So I think by now headache may be headache for you all by now, and maybe a boring topic, but very important topic. So what I want to highlight is, so far before going to childhood the headache approach, what we touched upon is that the importance of headache from the medical and this economic point of view, and the impact of the headache on the patient. And then when it coming down to the pathophysiology, we explained the anatomy and the physiology behind the headache, and now we are going to develop an approach. Now approach, of course, obviously, first of all, we have to see whether it is a primary headache or secondary headache. So that is our first business. And what we should touch first is the secondary headache. Actually, we have to eliminate secondary because that was can be dealt with. And then you come to the primary headaches, and then you are trying to fulfill the criteria and come up to a diagnosis. Then you talk about the management. So the approach is there are approaches is treating headache always. There will be a preventive element, and then there will be a symptomatic. So the acute phase has to be dealt with. There are two elements, that is the acute management and the possible the abortive phase of management, and then the symptomatic management. So treatment of secondary headache, of course, depend on the cause, and we have to deal with the cause. Therefore, we develop some red flags, as my registrar highlighted, the blood pressure is crucial, and then to see whether other causes of secondary headache evidence. So therefore, if there is a sudden onset headache, thunderclap headache, early morning headache, and there is disturbance in the consciousness, and if there is a worsening of the headache due to either cough or straining, then of course you know this is linked up with increased ICP. So, and if there is vomiting, fever, or other kind of focal neurological signs, so those are going as red flags. So, from approach point of view, first of all, when a child complains of headache, we have to see whether they are telling up with these findings. And then the headache evaluation algorithm is starting from the history and examination. So for a headache patient, at least you should spend about 10 to 15 minutes for their history and examination minimum to get into all this information. Otherwise, if you do a mistake, that will be too late to realize later on. We find sometimes a headache clinic, children with brain tumors come after 2 years of their initial presentation, and it is a bit pathetic. Though the society is not that critical in Sri Lanka, it is not fair by children. And so therefore the focus is on the examination, and whether we have to evaluate and see whether there is a need for imaging. This is a very important thing. Now you may wonder, when we are running a headache clinic, we see a lot of patients in our clinic, but we hardly do imaging. Roughly, say, 2 images for about 2 weeks, right? So roughly, less than 4 per month, right? So basically, if you do a thorough examination, the need for imaging will go down. But therefore, it is very important to touch up the red flag signs and to see very confidently that there is nothing wrong. And when you are going for brain imaging, there will be a struggle whether we are going for CT, which has radiation, and if you are going for MRI, you have to undergo anesthesia, which way is going to be placed. Then there is ultrasound. If the child is very small, they will not be able to complain headache, and going to place for ultrasound is very minimal. Then when you are going for imaging also, you might go beyond that to go for the arteriograms and the venograms, and then there will be a couple of lab tests, and then and clinically we come up with this so-called headache diary. We come up with that. So the vital signs, as I told you, the pressure is important, the fever and other general signs, and the sinus tendons, all these things are aiming at to eliminate possible secondary headaches. In fact, about the nuchal rigidity, you know, the nuchal rigidity is simply because to highlight and to say that there is meningismus. Meningismus is meninges are getting irritated. When the meninges are getting irritated, this muscle root will go into spasm, and there will be neck stiffness. If the child is big enough, because you might not detect neck stiffness in a child of say 9 months, 10 months, because their muscles are not strong enough to say that there is to reflect the spasm in the neck muscle. So therefore, very important to say the papillon, you have to have fundoscope in place, and if you are not sure, you can go over the rest of the eye examinations with the help of ophthalmologist. Need imaging based on the red tags usually, then appropriate imaging I told you. And CT and MRI, you have to understand that the CT is best for the bone and the blood, but MRI is good for the soft tissues. So depending on that is how you decide on the appropriateness of the imaging, not you are just saying MRI or CT. And the lab test, sometimes it is very important to highlight and see what actually causes this headache. Right. This is the headache diary in our clinical setting. You can gauge your headache severity this is very subjective, not objective, but that will build up some, when we are going to treat, if the patient can remember, we will be able to use this score by the limited approach, limited value with the pediatric practice, obviously. So therefore, if you are going to use the pain scale, that will improve your quality of your care, and that you are really going into their headache and you are quantifying the amount of headache, and the patient will build up their confidence on you. And then the location, where it's paining, that's why I told, if you ask to pictorially present, if you give a sheet of paper and they have to draw where it's paining, that will be important. And then the timing of other events, life events have to be touched up, then the possible triggers have to be listed, and then associated symptoms. So as I told you, from the prodrome, aura, then the headache phase and the postdrome, according to the phase, you will be able to highlight these findings. The children, of course, this phase will be much more important sometimes than going for a straightaway scale. And this is what is available in our headache clinic book. This is our clinic book that is incorporated into the headache clinic book for them to quantify at home, at leisure, not in our headache clinic. And then they are given a chart to quantify their daily headache severity in the respective chart. This chart is enough for the whole year, you can see, from January to December and from first to 31st. So you can mark, and then depending on the severity, you can. Then these are the questions we asked actually for to highlight our research on this immature headache. We were trying to grab all the information available and to give an international algorithm on pediatric headache management. So the other evaluations, of course, you might end up in highlighting the lumbar function, not only to see the CSF, but the pressure on the CSF also to its management. Then you might do EEGs depending on the situation to see where do you lie on your, because very importantly, these visual symptoms are common in occipital lobe epilepsy also. So how you differentiate occipital lobe epilepsy from the migraine is, the crude way is, usually the migraineous child will say black and white fine. The occipital lobe children, they will draw colored pictures. So that is something that is published in literature. If they say some colored bubbles are going on, it is better you do a EEG and see whether it is occipital lobe epilepsy, which you might pick up. So, but if it is black and white, and if there are geometric changes and other things, it is more in favor of migraine because the rescue limits. So the diagnosis I told you, and the first hurdle is to come up with the diagnosis, the examination, and fulfilling the criteria after going through the finding. And the short-term management goal is to alleviate, relieve the pain and nausea, both are important, and then to promote good sleep, is that itself will look after the acute phase. But in the long term, the quality of life is what is important when you are going to manage, and then to quantify the burden, and then the loss of their productive hours because of headache. Then economic management is also important, as I told you, because the neurological, what the most common neurological symptom in the world is headache, and then it is most easily treated condition also. It is very costly. You just have to carry only a ophthalmoscope and a good caring physician to look after that. So therefore, most parents, they only need a reassurance. So therefore, this slide will enlighten you that involving headache management, so it is so common, the involvement, and if you really touch up, that will reduce a lot of wastage on the healthcare cost. And this is the five things we say. This is the management, I think this slide I prepared for the registrar, very importantly, because you might say for them to drink water. I recently had a meeting with the ministry. They always ask to do physical exercise. So from the ministry policy makers, I asked, I also want them to get physical exercises. What is the universal physical exercise that you can suggest to these patients? Some patients are coming from a slum, some patients are coming from an environment that we have a place, garden to play and all, and some are coming from pandemonium. So what is the universal exercise that you can adapt as pediatricians for these kids? What is your suggestion? We'll discuss that later. So coming down to that, drinking water. So what I say is, I give, because now according to the literature, people think that if you have a big chat with the patient, that patient satisfaction will go up. So it is the opposite. They don't want big, I mean long chat with the patient. And the second thing is, we think that if you give 3-4 options to the patient, that patient is happy. So the patient satisfaction actually goes down according to the published literature. When you see the perception of the patient, they want exactly what they should do. Like, then that is why they turn back and doctor, if you are ill, what will you do? What will you do to your child? So they want exact precise guidelines. So therefore, what I do to save time and to enlighten them with our management protocol, I ask them to whenever they get up in the morning to drink 3 glasses of water. So with this magic number of 3 glasses, at least they will drink 1 glass. So therefore, then they ask the size of the glass, whether it is how many days and all these things, so that will develop a kind of a discussion among them, how many glasses, what size of glasses. So until this discussion will go to their home and then they will drink. And nowadays I say not only water, you can drink coconut water. So that is a very good solution. The sodium levels, potassium levels, this coconut water is almost similar to this Jeevani or the ORS. So therefore to drink coconut water, because then there will be engagement in the family with regard to the drinking and the hydration of the child. So then at least they will start drinking water and go to that place. And the second thing is, and at least that will initiate their day with 3 glasses of water, at least they will this drinking 3 glasses will look after until their interval. 11 o'clock or 10:30, by that time they will be fresh and better when they go and start their work in the school. The second thing is, then I ask them to drink throughout day. Drink. Especially some kids, they have headache when they get back from school. Obviously, because during the school stay, some schools they don't even advocate to drink, or sometimes they punish for drinking water because they say that children are trying to drink water to go to washroom to avoid classroom stay. So that is very bad actually. As a policy, we have to tell. And because of that, by the time they come home, they have severe headaches and then they sleep. So therefore, it's better before they leave school, drink enough water and come. Through this life. These are very important practical points. This is how I eliminated giving pharma to all these patients and maintaining this clinic with objective ways and subjective ways of their feedback in place and without giving medicine for more than 80% of these headache children. Then the other thing is daily bath. I think I have seen even Dr. Ajantan has said that unless you have a bath, don't come to my clinic like that, because people say it's a very, because having a bath is kind of a exercise that nobody should be, don't want any advocacy on that. But here, of course, in this country, for some reason, they have various myths, and so therefore, the better, as doctors, we say they should have a better bath every day that will refresh them. Then, meals at proper time, it's a difficult thing to say. Then, television. Now, even if you go to American Academy of Pediatricians, the maximum duration that child should be exposed to television for less than 2 years is 0. More than 2 years is maximum 1 hour, and they say if they go beyond 1-2 hours, it is definitely pathological from all angles. Pathological from physical, mental, social and all these aspects. So therefore, we have to ask, that is American Academy of Pediatrics. So even our pediatric college is better than if they give guidelines into the how they should look after their television and other instruments at home. Then 1 hour play. Why I say 1 hour is at least, I say usually sometimes 2 hours, at least 1 hour play. Sometimes they go to school in the morning and they come back and go for tuition, and sometimes they go for religious activities after 7 until after 5 o'clock to 7. So from 7 to 7, they are engaged. So even adult will not be able to provide that kind of a life cycle. And for all 6 days sometimes, 7 days sometimes. No, at least half a day for them to be on their own. Then a good sleep. I don't know, for some reason, sleep is a neurologist topic, but no neurologist is studying that sleep issue. And that is, you know, 1/3 of your life is sleeping. So the quality of life, if somebody wants to calculate, you can't avoid sleep and talk. So, and there are sleep directorates, sleep societies, and there is sleep center of excellence, I got down Professor Suresh Kottagar several times to Sri Lanka to talk about the sleep neurology. It's very poor attendance. People think that sleep is a natural and automatic thing. Sleep is a very active thing. So we have to manage sleep for the best interest, and by managing sleep, sometimes the epilepsy gets controlled and headache gets controlled. So that is crucial, and people always taken for granted, and people don't. The American child will have 8 items to handle, this iPhone, iPad, all these gadgets. Because of that, their time is taken out, and ultimately that will compromise their relaxing time and the sleep, very importantly. So if you are going to talk about the policy-oriented healthcare facilities in this country, if you avoid these things and talk, even the health message is not going to touch them unless you touch them very objectively, very important. So these are the 5 things I used to do. And so what is the universal sport that I can suggest to them? Any ideas? You know, when I asked from the FHP director and the DDG PHS, you are always asking to do physical activities at home. So what is the universal sport you are going to suggest? I said, I am for it. Tell me, I am not going to antagonize with you. Because for some other milk powder and other things I have to antagonize. But for this I said, I am in your side to tell us. So the answer was, ask them to go and dance at home. Ask them to play music and dance. So I don't know whether it is relevant in our context. So this is what I was told. I am not convinced of that. So what I am doing is, I am asking them to use a skipping rope at least for 30 minutes. Because whatever the form setting, that is feasible for their setting. So at least then they will do a check roll test, and I ask sometimes to get the grammar cell also to sign there, for just to emphasize that that is very important. The child will think that the grammar cell will come and see this thing. So then the child will do skipping and mark it with the parent. So this is how we used to encourage them to do the physical exercise, and that really works. Because when you do that, you know this is the second heart. Legs are the second heart. So when you do the skipping, that movement will work, and that will really generate good circulation to the brain, and that has an impact on this pathophysiology I explained on the vascular and the neurovascular theories to get rid of. Those are the simple techniques, those are not costly, which will benefit not only the their health status but the rest of the things also. So then the physiotherapy, I don't know whether in the adult headache clinic that you can ask the adult also to skip that, you have to find another physical activity. I think they are walking all the time. So children, we have to give a universal kind of advice rather than confusing them. So evidence for lifestyle modifications, I, for the completeness sake, I thought of touching, because I was, when I started the headache clinic, people are basically sarcastically telling that this is a clinic, no medicine, only what and exercises, whether it is going to work. And now it has really worked for last 10 years, and it's a very popular clinic, and Anuradhapur and Karapiti also, they are going to start headache clinic, they are neurologists. So screen time, of course, the best website is the AAP.org, that is the American Academy of Pediatrics website. If there is a Media and Child, is a very good site, very good material are there, you can go and visit. Physical activity, that's why I told, this is how we are going to manage, and that has a major impact on the headache management. Then the water intake, now of course you can ask them to drink Tamiri. Tamiri is very important. If you put small 2 drops of salt and 3 drops of orange or lime, that is how this Trincomalee and them, they are drinking Tamiri, then that the composition will almost come towards the ORS. So if you drink, you will not get a headache, especially during when you are studying. So that you will be able to utilize. And if you another point in the this Ayurveda, I can't say the traditional medicine, sometimes they say to use this pepper for some time and leave it for about 10 minutes and remove, then the so called phlegm issue will not come up. So plus, but adding small bits of salt and orange or lemon or lime is going to really very bad for a child. And the plastic bottles are not good. SLM is now glass bottle. Glass water, that is good. Then adequate sleep, very, very important. I am not going to touch that in detail, but it's very important. So at least 7 hours sleep had to be advocated. Satan, so what you say is, if they are getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning, by 10 o'clock they will, should be in sleep. So if they get up at 6 o'clock, so exactly you have to say, at what time you are going to sleep, at what time you are coming out. Those inquiries have to be made. Otherwise, that will not come to the real practical sense. So daily bath, no available study. Whether we do it. Then treatment. So the treatment, of course, there will be symptomatic treatment, abortive treatment and preventive treatment with pharma. Pharma, of course, there are few options. Because of the time constraints, I will quickly rush through these few slides. That now treatment, pharma treatment is only available, I think, pediatric headaches. For about 15%, the pharma will come into place. But rest of the things, we should be managed by the material I have shared with you all by now. So available pharma treatment, there is no ideal treatment in the pediatric practice, but it depends on the pharma therapies, depend on, you might use the clonazepam, the levodopa are usually, propranolol is for the adult practice, usually kids are not, unless they are in the adolescent, we don't use. The other option is this isotipan. So those are the two drugs, and then if there is a tension headache, I used to ask them for relaxation and all the lifestyle modifications. I go through their day habits, at what time they get up, come to the school, whether they play, and all these things. And when we say the parents that this child should be playing for 2 hours, more than anything, the child is so happy. And they are not allowed to climb a tree, they are not going to go out, and now in the families we have only a couple of kids. So therefore, always there is surveillance on children. So do you like you are getting surveillance all the time? You want time out for yourself. But kids, wherever they go, even you are behind, and then that will add up to your headache. So coming down to symptomatic treatment, so you have to, depending on the symptoms, if it is covered up in sinus and other things, the bisotipan may be the first line. Otherwise, we used to give clonazepam, and for the cost reason is also we are giving clonazepam at the first line. I will come to the, so you have to avoid the beta blockers because of asthma and children that we are giving. And the medication overuse headache I touched earlier on. So abortive treatment in the second line, we will see the drugs available. So basically the drugs are basically touching the neurochemicals I told you, they are either agonist or antagonist they are using. From that principle, and the paracetamol and the NSAIDs, yeah, analgesics. So the paracetamol, of course, you know, the corticosteroids act at the very higher level, but the NSAIDs act at the middle level, and the paracetamol is the benign form of analgesic. Is only the prostaglandin production is being stopped at this level. So therefore, paracetamol is the safest at the moment. And the pediatric college doesn't like using NSAIDs, especially because of dengue either. And corticosteroid is the place when it is very difficult. And then, so the mechanism of action, this study is based on the neurochemicals. I think you are not interested in pharmacology. So I have listed these slides for the medical student if they really want to go through. And this is how, as I told you, the chemicals are triggered, and then the brainstem will give it to the thalamus cortex and then generate pain. I told you earlier on also. So the preventive therapy again aims at the same principles, how it is been. So these are the list of drugs I have summarized in the last slide for your what you are studying. Protein, the action, how it happens based on the neurochemical systems and ADHD. And this is the evidence available. I think you are not that interested. I think if you list down the drugs, this is in one slide. So basically, the paracetamol, how it acts for the acute treatment is inhibitor of the prostaglandin synthesis. I told the insect, of course, at a higher level of that, we covering up the COX-1 and 2 inhibitors, sumatriptan, and it's basically vasodilatation is what is causing pain. So sumatriptan will keep the vessels constricted and will prevent give that same amount. So the ergometrin, again the chemical inhibitors in clonazepam, of course, related calcium channel inhibitor. I told you the calcium channel is what which will secrete all these neurochemicals. The bisotipan is actually not fully understood, but the expected theory is it has an impact on the histamines and serotonins, and then amitriptyline also they are blocking the norepinephrine and serotonin, and the topiramate again not very clear. And topiramate is a drug very important. People are using topiramate as an anti-epileptic. It's a fourth line anti-epileptic, but I have seen pediatric practice, the topiramate is used and first line. I would caution, where I was trained in Oxford, topiramate was a fourth line. America is a fourth line, but in Australasia it is going as a first line. And for this reason, the topiramate is a good drug for headache, not epilepsy. Of course, in the fourth line, actually, if you see the American. And so it's a very small amount is given in topiramate, and topiramate basically giving autonomous side effects. So this vomiting and other activities have been dealt with, the possibly dealt with topiramate. So topiramate, when you are going to use, we have to be cautious about it, because the FDA, I think, fined topiramate company at a time for using it for the wrong indication. So headache, dysphagia, I don't know whether the time is passed or it shall be monitored because of the protocol we put the speakers also. I think we will conclude at this point. This is our headache clinic book. If you are really interested of any of the books, we got about 10 copies here. Anybody who is interested will be able to use it. Thank you very much for your kind attention. So,